We're delighted that you're able to join us today. For those who do not know me, I'm Sandy Kumar. I'm a partner. I head up the financial services practice globally for the firm. So delighted that I'm meeting some of you, and hopefully I know some of you. So great to be seeing you. Today we've got a very sort of esteemed panel, and you know, and we will delve into their thoughts on negative yields and why you should be looking at liquid alternatives and cash plus solutions. The panel will be exploring the opportunities and challenges of alternative investments, the range of available products and activity managed solutions, as well as the potential risk and regulatory pressures. So I hope you're going to find this really informative. This is a sequence of things that we are doing at GT. And please, do make time and join whenever you can. I mean, most of the events will be posted regularly up, and I will be sharing the directory of that. But I'm going to hand over to Bobby, who'll be chairing the event. And Bobby is a senior advisor to our financial services group at Grant Thornton, and is also the CEO of OneFS Wealth. So Bobby, if I may hand over to you, please.
Great, thank you, Sandy. And once again, a warm welcome to all of the audience. We're looking forward to delving into our topic of the day. Just a few housekeeping points, if I may. So firstly, the event is being recorded. Secondly, the panelists are sharing their views. They are not Grant Thornton's views, and they've kindly given up their time. So thank you for that. We will be having a poll. I'm a big fan of polls during a session, so we can see what you're thinking about as an audience and why are we hosting the event. We're hosting it for you. We want to impart knowledge, but hear what you're thinking. So please do engage on the Q&As. We absolutely want to see as many questions coming in, and we will allow ample time for questions to be answered. So I just wanted to quickly say a few words from my side. So we wanted to host this event because we as a company, as OneFS Wealth, see what's happening from the perspective of wealth owners. What are they interested in and what are they concerned about? And what we've been seeing for a while now is a concern about negative yields. Where should they be allocating in the context of that? And secondly, off the back of inflationary concerns, and we are getting a number of people that have been coming to us, asking us as to what should they be doing in this environment. And as wealth owners, I think that it's all about garnering knowledge and understanding what's available as products. And if indeed you decide to go down the route of executing on those products and allocating to those products, how do you actually do it? So that's really why we put together what I feel is a very well-rounded panel, so we can help with guidance with all aspects of that. So I'm going to hand over to the panelists. The panelists are going to do a very short intro and just define their credentials with respect to the topic. Afterwards, we're going to launch straight into the questions. We have got a few rapid fire questions, which I will intersperse, which are simple yes, no answers. And as I mentioned earlier, we have got a poll, a series of poll questions, three or four, depending on time. And so please do engage with those. So let's get cracking. And firstly, over to Davide.
Thank you. Thank you, Bobby, and good afternoon, all. I run Kaleidoscope Capital as a firm which I founded in 2014. We have a specific focus on providing customized advisory solution to clients on alternatives. And the core skill set and core focus on liquid alternative investment solution. In terms of my background before setting up KC, I was working for Generali Group Insurance as a portfolio manager and allocator to the hedge fund space for them. And my life before finance, military background, the Navy, which I'm always proud to remember.
Good stuff. Thank you, Davide. And Matthew, over to you.
Great. Thank you, Bobby. I'm certainly feeling very well-rounded after the latest lockdown. I graduated in maths and computer science more than two decades ago, and I joined the hedge fund industry in a quant hedge fund, a little unknown quant hedge fund. And over my 17 years there, it grew into a much bigger beast. That was Winton Group. It went on to become one of the largest European systematic hedge funds. I was there 17 years, 9 of which I was the chief investment officer. I always like to think I spent the first decade of my career trying to explain to people what a hedge fund is. And then courtesy of the Wolf of Wall Street movie in 2013, I've been having to spend a lot of time explaining what it is not. Back in 2017, I actually was supported by Winton to launch a new business in the form of Havelock London. And this is a more traditional form of investment. We are long-term value investors, albeit with a more flexible mandate than your traditional mutual fund. So that's me.
Thank you. Tony, over to you.
Yeah, hi. My name is Tony Hughes. I'm a PhD in econometrics. My background, my accent is Australian, but my professional career has actually been spent more in the United States, where I was a managing director in credit research for Moody's Analytics for many, many years. I recently joined Grant Thornton just in the last, just in the first half of this year, and I'm predominantly working on, quantitative modeling issues, especially ESG related to banking and credit, and just broader issues of credit modeling and related tasks for banks, so stress testing and IFRS 9 and a full suite of different modeling type engagements.
Fantastic, thank you. And then Carolyn, over to you.
Thank you very much, Bobby. My name is Carolyn Schoenherr. I run Risk as Service, an advisory firm for non-financial risk management. And really, at the moment, I mainly look at readiness for operational resilience, climate risk topics that we really, as an industry, are all getting guided by the regulators more and more to invest time and effort in. Previously, I was in charge of the resolution unit operational risk management team at Credit Suisse, so all the assets that were no longer part of the mainstream offering and making sure that they were offboarded in effective and cost efficient manner. And more recently, I've set up operational risk management at Capula, 23 billion asset under management hedge fund, and started to really think about how in a hedge fund can you make sure that all the amazing ideas are executed and without incurring any losses or incidents.
Great, thank you. And then Michael, over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm a portfolio manager at Tungsten Capital in Frankfurt, Germany. We are a team of 13 people, specialized derivatives-based multi-asset strategies. And I personally have been, for the past 20 years, creating and managing uncorrelated AI-based investment strategies, which complement both equity and fixed income exposure.
Brilliant, thank you. Okay, so that's great. And I'm sure you'll all agree that we have a pretty amazing lineup of panelists, and they've got an awful lot of knowledge to impart. So let's get going. So look, the first question is actually off the back of events yesterday, what was happening with the Fed? So there was a frisson of excitement around what the Fed was going to do with respect to rates. And I think we all heard about it, saw it, felt it. To the panel and to everyone on the panel, what were your views on the Fed's decision? And more broadly, what are your views with respect to global rates and where they're headed? And coupled with that, inflation, which is clearly a big issue at the moment. So if I can, I'm going to go through people as I see them on my screen. So Carolyn first, please.
Well, I think actually when we talk about employment, inflation and interest rates, we also need to take speed of vaccination in there, because to me, that is the one that will free up employment and that is the one that will then drive inflation and interest rates. The Fed have now said that they will hike before 24. I suspect 9 months from now, if you were to ask me.
OK, great. Matthew, over to you.
Great. So I must admit, I normally avoid making macro forecasts. But clearly the size of the economic stimulus we've seen is eye-watering. As Larry Summers pointed out, in the US it's about 3 times the GDP shortfall, so it is massive. It's occurred as a result of governments taking on debt and money being printed. As I see it, there are only 2 ways to clear that debt. Number one is to tax us all, and pay it back. And number two is for governments and banks to inflate their way out. My own personal view is I think it's more likely that they will choose to inflate their way out. I think that's the easier, more politically palatable option. As to when rates go up or by how much and the path of inflation, I don't know, but I think it's fair to say within the next decade ahead, my money would be on us seeing inflation and rates rising.
Great stuff, thank you. Tony, over to you.
Yeah, thank you. I must say I'm more of a Japan file. I spent a long time covering the Bank of Japan and its various monetary decisions over the decade, probably from around 2000 to 2010, predominantly. My general view on inflation at the moment, both in the UK and in the States, is that it is really due to temporary factors related to COVID. I don't think that there's the mechanism in place to transmit those inflationary pressures into wages. So there's just not the same sort of level of organized labor that there existed back in the 1970s. And so it's very unlikely that we're going to move into a wage price spiral. I think that once the supply chain issues, the logistical problems brought about by COVID, and then the switch back on of the lights, once that sort of the dust is settled on that, I think that the inflation that we're seeing at the moment will actually start to drift away.
Good stuff, thank you. And Davide?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think that the Fed intervention, Fed speech yesterday was very balanced. In the end, they recognized some temporary inflationary pressure. But at the same time, it seems that by the long-term view, the trajectory is not as worrying as it could be for the last few months. And I kind of share this view. So for sure, we are having, particularly in the United States and even the UK, some kind of pressure from that point of view. But I don't believe that there is a big pressure for the long term.
Okay, great. And that sort of weaves into, you know, one of our questions for the poll. You know, do you think that inflation is here to stay, or is it transitory? But we'll come on to that in a second. So, Michael, over to you.
Yes. Well, to second what Matthew has said, I think the given current debt levels, it is highly unlikely that we will at least see negative real rates for quite some time going forward. I'm not sure if the expectation of inflation as we currently see it is here to stay. That may be just a shorter period, but for the longer term, I think negative real rates is what I'm sort of preparing myself for. And also, like Matthew said, I'm not in the profession of making such forecasts, but that's what my take on the situation really is.
Great. Okay. And then if we can just launch the poll question, which is relevant to this. Is inflation transitory or here to stay? And then let's carry on. Okay, so thank you very much all. Let's go into a few more targeted questions. So what I wanted to do was try and attack the point about the problem, negative yields. And what are we going to do about that in terms of investors' allocations? So a question for Davide and Michael first, please. We are living in a world of negative bond yields and increased inflationary concerns, as we just discussed. What is the impact on investors' allocation choices? And is there a difference from the perspective of German investors? Clearly, that bit's for Michael. So, Davide, first, please.
Well, I think the impact is huge. I mean, for the last 20, even more years, we have been used to face a very benign environment for bond investors. You could have accrual of coupons, and you did have interest rates going down, and so providing capital gains to your investment in bonds. Now we are really at a very, very low level. Negative yields, nominal yields, more or less everywhere in Europe and also in the States. And a concern about inflation. I mean, you might have different views, but bottom line, the expectation and the reality, more importantly, for now, is that investors in bonds have a negative real and nominal yields. And this is news. The real question here is to understand if this is a transitionary or a long-term scenario. We are believing this is more a long-term scenario, but is a completely new environment for bond investors.
Great, thank you. And then Michael, same question, and then with that perspective from the German side, please.
Yes, I think I would certainly agree. We're coming out of a tremendously favorable environment, and government bonds have played the best possible role in portfolios, having low correlation, often negative with equities. So very, very important building block for portfolios has simply fallen away. And from conversations we're having with investors, we observe that more and more they have exhausted their options in the fixed income space in terms of moving to more and more longer duration and accepting higher credit risk. And that seems to be a very difficult transition to then make, because if those options are exhausted, where can they turn to next? So I think what we're discussing today is highly topical. And to add the German perspective, it is, of course, the same dilemma that German investors find themselves in. But interestingly, German investors don't have a strong tradition of allocating to hedge funds nor liquid alternatives in particular. But they too, and that's what we observe, and that's probably even more telling, are beginning to turn their attention to liquid alternatives as well, and actually making allocations. And like I said, they're not the first ones to move here, but seeing them make that that transition in that direction is quite telling.
Great, thank you. Hopefully you can all see the results of that part of the quick poll. And it's significantly in favor of transitory, which is, seems to be the view echoed by the panel for the most part. Thank you. And then just moving on, Michael, I just wanted to drill down a bit more in terms of a survey that you conducted in the region, in your region, about the views of investors on govy bonds and possible alternatives. Can you maybe just expand on that briefly?
Yes, thanks. I'll give you the key takeaways of that survey, which is a couple of months back. 85% of respondents said that, and that comes as no surprise, that government bonds have lost their yield-bearing function. And more than 50% still said that they hardly offer any protective function in a portfolio context anymore. We've also found that as bond yields first turned negative, that was the moment when half of the participants first turned their attention to alternatives, started looking for alternatives, or actually making such allocations. And we've also asked in the survey, what are the key requirements of investors when it comes to alternatives of fixed income allocations? And again, no surprise, positive yield or return is number one, followed by low correlation with equity markets and a moderate level of volatility. Still, more than 50% felt that daily liquidity and protection in market downturns would be an important feature of fixed income alternatives. And maybe as a summary, the findings of the survey suggest that the quest for fixed income alternatives is in full swing already.
No, thank you. Okay, so moving on. So Matthew, this is to you. How would you describe liquid alternatives? I mean, we've covered some of the problem areas, like negative yields, what's going on. So if you can, give me a synopsis on your definition of liquid alternatives, and then how appropriate are liquid alternatives as substitutes for bonds or cash, and where do investors need to be cautious when considering a replacement?
So my view, perhaps controversially, is that I don't think liquid alternatives are an asset class. They're not an asset class. What they are is that they are a product structure, and they have some common characteristics, which is they are liquid, so you can buy or sell them easily. They're cheaper than traditional hedge funds, so they're not subscribing to a 2-20 fee structure or a 1-20 fee structure. And they're attempting to do something other than just being long stocks or long bonds. But within that, you've got a real mixed bag. You know, you've got more traditional hedge fund strategies like long short equity, macro funds that are using derivatives to place macro bets, distressed credit funds, catastrophe bond funds, lumber funds, even some sort of property or infrastructure funds might call themselves liquid alternatives. So really my punchline in terms of how do I think investors should approach the space is that you need to really look at each on its own merits. I don't think you can think of it like an asset class. You need to actually look at the particular strategy, understand and get comfortable with it. Clearly, what we all want is something that pays a decent rate of return and isn't going to fall at the same time that the stock and bond markets do. It turns out that's much easier to say than it is to do. And so that's really the challenge for investors, I think, is to look at a particular liquid alt opportunity and really decide whether it stacks up for them.
Yeah, no, thank you. And Davide, same question to you, please.
Well, absolutely. I totally agree with Matthew. I wouldn't say liquid alternative represent an asset class. It's a big word. You need to be careful in what you look at and what you select. I think the main common feature is an absolute return mindset of the portfolio manager. So the idea is not to compare yourself with a benchmark, but to bring a positive return at the end of the year. You got differences. Hedge funds uses a different structure, but I think this is the main common feature we're looking for and the way you achieve that.
Great, thank you. And Michael, over to you. Same question, please.
Yes, well, I would agree that you can find something suitable in the space to actually replace some of your fixed income exposure, particularly for the property's positive rate of return and liquidity. But I think, and I agree with what's been said just now, the space is highly heterogeneous, which means that investors looking for alternatives should really be very mindful to define their expectations they have from liquid alts, because you can find strategies that have lower, moderate or high volatility, low correlation with equity markets. Some actually can benefit from inflationary tendencies or provide a cushion in market downturns. But that's just, you know, there are so many options to choose from that I think, Davide and Matthew just said, you really have to make up your mind what you expect of that allocation and how to best replace fixed income or what properties has fixed income had for you in the past. What advantages are you seeking?
Yeah, perfect. And let's talk later on about where do you see the set of investment and where do you go and look for them in terms of data. We'll talk about data and tech in a few minutes. But just a quick fire or rapid fire question to all of you. When do you think that the Fed will raise rates? And it's interesting, we keep on talking about the Fed as if there aren't any other countries out there or central banks out there. But with that question in mind, let's go to Michael first. If you can just give me what your view on when do you think that they will raise rates? Ideally, not a year, but a month and a year.
early 24, I believe.
Okay, that's really good. Davide?
Well, I will stick to what they say yesterday, 2023.
Okay, that's good. Okay, and then Tony?
I'll say February 30, 21. How about that? I think it's sort of indefinite, let me put it that way.
Okay, that's fine. And Matthew?
I think later than it will turn out that they should have done.
Okay, all right. That's interesting as an answer. Okay, and then Carolyn?
Listen, just following what the chairman said yesterday, you know, he said it's not 24, it's going to be twice in 23. So if we think where we are today and you say if you want to do this twice in 23, you know, Q1, Q2, 23, something has to shift if they stand by it, unless they claim everything has changed again.
Sure. Okay, no, that's great. Look, thank you for that. All right, so let's move on. And we're going to do another poll question. So to the audience now this time. So when do you think the Fed will increase rates? So you've heard what the panelists think. So make your own mind up, and please do respond to the poll. And let's move on with the questions. So this question is for Carolyn and Anthony. So it's really talking about asset reallocation is driven by market development and portfolio managers. So from your experience, where do you think that managers should be putting their planning focus before the execution of the asset reallocation? So Carolyn first, please.
Thanks, Bobby. And I think, you know, I would always start with saying, are you aware and do you understand in your organization what this will entail? You know, you will, whether you manage client money in a managed account or in a fund, but do you fully understand what this new investment will mean? Do you have the systems? Do you have trained, have you trained your people? I mean, it's that simple as, you know, can you actually value and settle this? And this sounds very, very basic, but often what we find is that people get really excited by profit and idea and great, but actually we lose money in the way of executing and implementing it. And, you know, think very simply about, you know, maybe the last year or so, at some point physical commodities seemed a really good idea. And all of a sudden, a lot of people wanted to trade it, necessarily not with, you know, not necessarily having the right executing broker relationships, not having all the right SSIs set up. So I think, to me, two things. A, check your internal capabilities, and B, check your client agreements. Is this within your mandate? Is this within what you're authorized to do by the client? Because both of those can make you lose any money that you make from an ever so attractive trade real quick.
Sure. Thank you. And Tony, same question, please.
Yeah, I mean, like, I just think that it's important for, you know, for, you know, in the context of a reallocation of assets, I think it's just important to understand the customer, understand the client, the investor, their stage of life, what they're trying to get out of their investment, their risk appetite, and just making sure that, you know, that those needs are met. And really, just I just sort of echo what Carolyn said on this. Just basically know your customer, and, you know, do the right thing by your customer, and everything should work out, you know, perfectly fine, I'd imagine.
Okay, thank you. And then we've just had the poll results in, and it's split really between 2022 and 2023. We couldn't really provide any more answers with a lower level of granularity, but interesting to see what the audience are thinking there. Question for you, Matthew. So, Matthew, you are a CIO at Winton, as you've mentioned already. What are your current thoughts on the hedge fund and liquid alts landscape?
So I think the general investment landscape that we've seen in the last two decades has changed. We've seen this big growth in passive investing, so price insensitive investors. We've seen this big growth in asset purchases from central banks and governments. You know, even if you look carefully, you'll see the Swiss central bank has actually been buying shares in big tech companies. You know, they are owners of Apple shares. We've also seen a big proliferation of hedge funds. It's been a pretty lucrative game, and so the number of managers has grown as the strategies become more widely accepted as something legitimate. So I think, on the one hand, we've seen a big sort of structural shift in the nature of markets and the makeup of markets. And on the other hand, there's been a big sort of proliferation of products. You know, my view is, and I guess it's really going back to what I was saying before, is that I think it's more important than ever that potential investors are discriminating. I mean, in particular with the markets that we've seen in the last decade, there have been a lot of sort of one-way trends. So if you're just trying to choose a liquid alt product that's made very, very good returns, you need to be confident that it's made good returns for the right reasons. If it's made good returns because it's just owns the same underlying assets as, you know, traditional stock and bond funds that have done very well, then you might not be getting the diversification that you're seeking. So my real view is that I think there are a lot of very talented and capable managers out there, but there's an awful lot of sort of mediocre products. And so I really think it's incumbent on investors to do their due diligence, understand what they're investing in, and really understand where that diversification will be coming from.
Sure, thank you. And then Davide, same question to you, please.
Well, I think I think you need to maintain a looking forward approach. I mean, when you do investments, you tend to look at history, at what worked before, and you've got kind of assumption that history is going to repeat itself. And to some extent, this is true, but at the same time, things evolve continuously. And I think it's important to maintain an attitude where you try to understand what's happening, which are the opportunities, and what is the best way to exploit those opportunities. I think right now we are in a situation where, at least in my personal view, there is a kind of paradigm shift. Equities did overly well for the last 20 years or so, bonds did overly well for the same period, and you need to think about different structure to explore the opportunity set and to propose what clients in the end are always looking for. Good performance, not too much volatility, and a safe way where to park their money.
Great. Okay, thank you. And then just a quick fire question. So in terms of this specific time slice at the moment that, and the cycle that we're going through, do you think this actually reenacts a previous moment in time, a time frame? For example, maybe the 70s or 2007 pre-GFC. So if I can ask Michael first.
Well, I'm really reluctant to proclaim that things are different now and you know, very unique, but I'm hard pressed to not say it, given that for the first time we're having negative rates and we're, you know, government support and stimuli have been so impressive. Debt levels are certainly also impressive, and it sort of smells like MMT is just around the corner if it's not already here. So I find it really difficult to make a comparison to a historical situation.
Good. And Tony?
Well, we were joking just before the session started about how far back we were allowed to go, and I suggested that the fall of the Roman Empire might be a good comparison point, but I'm not sure if I think I was only joking. But no, I mean the key differences between now and, for example, the 1970s is that, you know, the world has moved on. I mean, like, you know, things like I said in the, you know, in the macro discussion earlier, I mean, you know, organized labor is much more fragmented than it was in the 1970s. Mm-hmm. So the 70s sort of rules don't apply. You know, you had oil embargoes back then, and they had a major impact on the economy, and you wouldn't imagine that type of those type of shortages having any effect these days. Prior to the GFC in 2007, you know, the situation again was very distinct. I mean, we've sort of learned the lessons, we've digested the effect of the GFC, I think, and the world is still marked by that. So I don't see the same imbalances in the markets that were present in 2007. So I think that the industry is still digesting those lessons, and so I don't think it's a repeat of that either. So I think that we've got to either go further back in history, or we've got to imagine that this actually is different.
Understood. Thank you. And then Carolyn, over to you.
Well, you know, given that Michael and Tony have talked about market and rational behavior, I actually think we should not forget how people feel after the last 15 months. And I think what we see at the moment is the re-entry in society, and people have this urge to celebrate, people have an urge to spend, people have an urge to congregate again. And I can't help it, but that brings me back to pictures of the 20s.
Yeah.
And okay, let's hope that that's not a predictor for anything else, but I think we must not underestimate how people feel after 15 months of being locked up.
Yeah, that's a fair point, and thank you. Matthew?
I very much agree with Michael. I think history doesn't repeat, but it rhymes. But with that said, actually, I'm with Carolyn. It does feel a little bit like the 20s. The idea that of buy the dip, it's a little bit like the idea of stocks reaching a permanently new high plateau. I think there's a risk with people thinking that asset prices only ever go up. I think there's a risk to society that you have this growing inequality between those of us that own assets and are doing very well and those of us that don't and aren't. And so, yeah, I definitely see some hallmarks of the 1920s in what we're seeing right now.
Yeah, sure. And just a question for you then. So with respect to your current strategy, how are you going to deal with these with this exuberance in the markets and when markets do sell off, as indeed they will at some point? What's your strategy going to be?
So my motivation for doing what I do very much is the view that people's attention span in markets has been shortening, holding periods have been shortening. There's been more in the way of short-term trading activity. I think there's been more in the way of prices disconnecting from fundamentals. You know, give me free popcorn, I don't care about the balance sheet. I think that is creating opportunity for longer term value investors. And so that is what I am doing. You know, quite often we invest in quite boring companies, but we are trying to do sort of cold-hearted data analysis to figure out what a business is worth. And quite often we're tripping over companies whereby there's some short-term distraction, which I think is putting other investors off. But actually, if you're prepared to look through that, then we see longer term opportunities. So yeah, for me, it's, you know, back to basics, long term fundamentals. That's where I see opportunity.
Great, thank you. And then Davide, over to you. And if you can maybe answer both parts of that question. So maybe answer that bit about what timeframe are we reenacting? And then also with respect to the products that you have created, how are you going to be dealing with markets as they tend to oscillate around with a higher vol in the future?
Yeah, absolutely, Bob. I share Michael's view. I think bottom line is always difficult to compare present with past, but negative rates, negative yields is a kind of new environment in our view. And this is representing a very important challenge for investors because besides what you have available, besides the level of rates, in the end, investors always look for some kind of positive yield. In terms of what we do have an expertise and the focus on liquid alternative investments and total return investment solutions. What we do is selecting opportunities and strategies that per se they are able to provide a stable return, low correlation to equities and bonds, and we put them together in a way to create a bond-like return. As Michael pointed out, it was quite interesting, the data I was sharing about German investors, what they're looking for. In the end, the perception is that investing in bond, you look for two things, positive yield at the end of the year and some kind of differentiation from equity. So we're trying to recreate this through alternatives.
Sure. So your products should be impervious to any corrections in equity markets. Is that what you're saying?
Well, look, we like equities, we like illiquid alternatives, but in the end, you need to keep things that can be liquidated in one day or a week. And if you have this requirement, I think liquid alternative is one of the solution, or possibly the solution we prefer on that regard.
Yeah, sure. Great. So thank you. And then a question for Tony. Tony, you've done a fair bit of work, in fact, a lot of work, helping banks think about the shift to negative rates. Can you maybe just talk us through what those projects have involved, and you know, what are the concerns that your clients have been relaying to you?
Well, sure. I mean, this has been consulting work primarily with large banks, and again, primarily in North America. There was a couple of years ago, we were in sort of a fairly similar situation, and quantitative easing was sort of starting to sort of run out of steam, run out of legs, assuming it ever had any. And there was talk about negative rates being implemented, and so banks were interested in this from a variety of different perspectives.
but primarily it was the impact on their deposit bases and the nature of their deposits, the duration of their deposits and so forth was the primary focus. So basically funding, you know, deposits are a very cheap way for banks to fund their operations. And, you know, obviously if negative rates come along and depositors sort of, you know, do a mass exodus of, you know, insured deposits from the banks, then that obviously can destabilize them and cause them, you know, sort of liquidity problems and so forth. So what we found, so we investigated, Sweden is the most interesting country to investigate along this path because they were the first to try out negative interest rates on deposits. And then They're also interesting because they've gone both in and out of negative rates. So basically they moved into negative rates in 2009, they moved out, I think it was in 2011, and then they basically moved back in a couple of years later. So they've made several moves on both sides of the frontier. What we found in our study was that the impact on large deposit accounts and on time and term deposits was you know, roughly sort of symmetric in the sense that, you know, the impact of going from 1% to zero was roughly the same as the impact of going from zero to negative one. So it was sort of symmetric in the sense that deposits declined as you moved into further into negative territory. But the interesting thing was that demand deposits actually turned around. So if you take a, you know, if you as you're in positive territory coming down, demand deposits tend to fall with subsequent declines in interest rates. But as you cross the threshold into negative rates, you find that people are actually moving their funds into demand deposits, demand deposit accounts, which is quite interesting. So overall, just a very quick summary is that the duration of deposits for banks were actually, you know, was actually shorter. So there was more focus on demand deposits, and, you know, but generally speaking, the actual overall decline in deposits was relatively muted, and that's because the vast majority of deposits for banks are actually held in demand deposit accounts.
That's very interesting. Do you have that report available? Is that a publicly available report, something that you can share if the audience are interested?
It is, yes. It's on the letterhead of my former employer, but I can absolutely provide a link to that.
Okay, I think that would be really interesting. So thank you very much for that. Okay, so let's do a poll question, and then we can move on to the questions for the panelists. So this is really about have you started as an audience to react to the low yield environment, and what asset classes or strategies are you currently using for this purpose? And we've clearly given you a few to consider. I'd be very curious to see what the answers are here. I was actually on a asset allocation panel yesterday, I was surprised that some of the thoughts on allocating in this environment. So as I said, I'd be curious to see, as with the panelists, as to how you respond. So whilst the audience is answering that, let's move on to technology. So starting with you, Matthew, because clearly you've been all about tech and data, and I'm intrigued as to you know, how you've actually capitalized, if that's the right word, on what you were involved with at Winton. And how you've applied that to your current portfolio at Havelock. So so this is to everyone, it's question is, are you seeing using AI and ML, natural language processing, to help run your business and drive your investment decisions? Related to that, what technology solutions are you using? So in terms of the infrastructure, but also tools, I think the audience will be really interested in that. So to you, Matthew, first, please.
Sure. So my background is definitely from a high technology business. In both my career there and in my new career, I see things like AI, machine learning, NLP. They really are just tools, techniques, you know, what the way I really approach it is to think about what do we want to do and then try and find the most appropriate tool for the job. So a lot of what I've done, you could characterize machine learning, but equally a lot of the way I've used technology in my career is actually just automating mundane things. And I'm a big believer that if you can use technology to leverage yourself, automate the mundane, then it just gives, you know, me as a human being more bandwidth to concentrate on important things. So yeah, definitely used some machine learning, but I see it very much as the cart that's leading the horse, not the horse itself. In terms of technology, we're in this luxurious environment where we have cloud computing. In the old days, every time we had weather like this, I used to get lots of calls about the air conditioning units breaking down. That's a thing of the past. You can just pay Amazon or Google to do that. So definitely where we are now, we don't need to have physical computers. It can all just happen on the cloud. So that's thing number one, which is great for business. Thing number two is the rise of open source software. We've built a lot of in-house technology with the use of open source software, stuff that's available off the shelf. That I could have only dreamed of having access to 20 years ago. So we do a lot of coding in Python. There's a lot of tools and technologies that hang off Python that can really allow you to do an awful lot with an awfully small amount of effort. That's really our setup.
So that's great to hear. Thank you. And then Carolyn, over to you.
See, I would like to pick up something as you just said there on the automate mundane tasks. And I would actually add to that a non-financial risk manager, when you start to automate these mundane tasks, you actually reduce the error rate. And at that point, you can utilize people to make judgment calls. You can utilize their skill set. But I would also add that my main interest is in data architecture, because no matter how clever any tool and how any AI or machine learning is, if we haven't got clear data architecture ownership and lineage under that, the machine learning is useless. And so again, I think, you know, we'd often talk about we should have algorithmic trading, we should have automated, but if my algorithm assumes that interest rates can only ever be positive, how good is the outcome of my algorithmic trading ever going to be?
Good. Thank you. Davide, over to you.
In terms of investment decision, I would say we use a man and machine model. So some things we do are completely discretionary, qualitative. At the same time, we use extensively statistical methods and also machine learning techniques to improve the way we look at investments, particularly in terms of portfolio construction and risk management. The point that Carolyn made about data, I fully share that. The point, I think, building up a good data set is crucial in making more effective investment decision. We spend a lot of time on that in a customized way, depending on what are client requirements at the same time. While the second point of your question on from a business point of view, of course, we try and we aim to use as much as possible new platforms, new tools that we are going out to the market. So we try to be more efficient as possible in spending our time, the team time in developing the business and using tools in that regard.
Good stuff. Thank you. And then Michael, over to you.
Yes, well, as a quant shop, we've embraced AI very early on, and our investment decisions have been based on machine learning and AI for many years now. We regard it as a way to arrive at a different perspective on what's happening in the markets to provide us with different trading opportunities. And as such, AI to us is a powerful and very useful tool that can make useful predictions, including rising or falling yields, by the way. And it allows us to flexibly manage portfolios and react to changing market conditions. We're great fans of AI and machine learning.
Great. Great, thank you. Tony?
I would just sort of, I'd just bring up the point about transparency and about responsible AI. Because I think that like a number of organizations in somewhat less regulated industries have, you know, sort of tied themselves up in knots using AI techniques. The problem with AI is that it's, you know, it's obscure. You know, I mean, it's hard to know exactly how the AI is doing what it's doing. And it's hard to fully understand exactly what the process underlying it is. So, but the point is that there is a push in the industry to move towards more transparent approaches to AI. And I think that the banking industry has probably been a little bit slow on the adoption of AI into a lot of its processes. But, you know, but the form of AI that's being adopted within the banks is much more sort of transparent and, you know, is forced to be responsible because of the heavy regulatory burden that banks face. So it's an interesting sort of a dynamic, but I think it's sort of an issue where sort of the banks truly have been saved by the heavy hand of the regulator, if you catch my drift. The types of AI that the banks are doing are actually really interesting as a result of that.
Yeah, thank you. And then you can see the results, hopefully, everyone, from our poll. And I have to say that clearly the audience is very much aligned with liquid alts, and that's great to see. And surprised that private debt didn't feature higher, but clearly it's contingent upon the audience. But as I said yesterday on my asset allocation panel, there was definitely a strong bias towards private debt. So great to see that result in favor of liquid alts today. Okay, so just moving on, a rapid fire question. What do you all think about the news with JP Morgan acquiring Nutmeg, i.e. in the context of robo-advisory? I don't know if you saw that. If you didn't, then please comment anyway. But just quickly going around, everyone. Carolyn, any thoughts? I mean, clearly it sort of weaves into what we've been talking about with AI and ML and NLP.
I think it's targeting a younger generation. I think it's bifurcating the market into automated advice for a bigger group and then into a high quality personal advice in the other part of the market.
Perfect. And if you can all be really pithy with your responses, thank you. Matthew, over to you.
Nutmeg, it's great brands. I think using computers to structure portfolios is the way forward, but I think people still will probably require a little bit of human touch.
Yeah, very good. Tony?
Well, I really like the potential of robo traders. The thing about, like I said before, that you know it's hard for AI to be transparent, but it's even harder for the human brain to be transparent. And so I think that as a quant guy, as a technical person, I could understand at least the methodology behind the AI, and then, you know, I could become more comfortable with the way that the AI is allocating investments to various funds, and it's probably easier to do that in some respects than it is to understand the human brain.
Sure, thank you, Michael.
Well, I think it's a natural extension of the business model, firstly, and it ties in nicely with a trend towards passivization of asset management. So, it's quite straightforward, I believe.
Good. Davide?
Well, I really like robo-advisory models. At the same time, I think this model will coexist with more traditional one. So you still need some human interaction with your financial advisor or your private bankers. At the same time, new generation millennials are increasingly keen to use just technology. So that's a good move for sure. And it's an interesting field to be in.
Good, thank you. So, okay, we've got a question now in terms of what's changed in the hedge fund world? And this is for Matthew, Michael, and Davide. So with respect to hedge funds and liquid alts, what's changed with respect to the opportunity set and what risks are there to investors going forward? And you've touched on some of them. Matthew, you made it very clear that you know, what are liquid alts? There are so many different buckets within that. You should be looking very carefully at what you should allocate to. But just maybe expanding on that, and how have you seen the evolution over your career with respect to hedge and liquid alts? So Matthew first, please.
So I mean, for the last 40 years, all we've seen is falling interest rates. I think there's a big risk to investors that interest rates don't continue to fall under that environment, that all of us know nothing other than falling interest rates could prove to be a game changer. That I think is a forward-looking risk. What's sort of changed right now in recent history? I think the amount of central bank and government intervention in markets really has changed. You get a sense that central banks are fearful of the stock market. They can't afford to have it go down. And I think that encourages investors to have a very different attitude towards risk. It encourages investors to have a sort of, you know, buy the dip mentality, because you can't possibly lose. I do think that ramp up in stimulus has actually impacted the hedge fund space in recent years. I think it has, certainly for a lot of hedge fund strategies, it's pushed this decoupling between prices and fundamentals that I mentioned earlier. So I think, you know, it's some of these big macro things I think have caused some structural changes. I think the big risk to investors is if those structural changes change, you know, what if interest rates don't fall forever? What if they go up? What if governments and central banks decide that actually they can afford for asset owners to suffer a bit of pain? You know, those are the things that I think would really provide investors with a shock. So I really think, as far as both hedge funds and liquid alts work, you really need to understand, what is that mechanism that's providing me with my source of return? And why should it be different from just owning stocks or bonds? Where does that differentiation come from? And if you can't understand it, if there's not a clear story, then don't buy it. That's very much my view.
Yeah, that's great. And do you feel that investors have become more astute over the years with respect to identifying performance attribution and alpha versus beta, etc.?
I do think that we've obviously had a big push towards transparency around the results that people are getting, the outcome they're getting. So measuring my performance against the benchmark. So I do think it's made fund buyers more astute. I do also think there's just been a lot of popularization of strategies. When I went into the industry, Winton's main strategy was trend following, and we had a very lucrative run from that strategy. I can go on Amazon now and I can buy a textbook describing how to build a trend following algorithm. The sort of algorithm that we would have been using commercially 20 years ago. So I very much feel as though when you're in a minority doing something in financial markets, it can be a great idea. But the moment that the crowd arrives, the moment that people start publishing textbooks on a particular technique, that's when you've got to be a bit worried. And so I do think that, you know, the more successful strategies, I think, will have, you know, one eye on the future, not just trying to replicate something that has been successful in the past.
Yeah, no, thank you. And then Michael, same question to you. And then in terms of you and your products, how do you differentiate?
Well, I think I can give one answer to both these questions. I think one of the biggest risks to both investors and hedge fund or fund managers alike is the tremendous support of traditional asset classes. So there's been this tremendous drift upwards, and I suppose it's even more of a temptation for retail or end investors to follow that drift. And as an alternative manager, you end up at a turning point. You have to make a decision: are you going to buy into that drift? Because you're well aware that, you know, with all the support of government banks, central banks, and governments, you're likely seeing rising markets. At the same time, it's our business to provide tremendously diversifying and very much uncorrelated products. So that tension, well, we found an answer to that, obviously, and we remain a very diversifying strategy, not buying into that drift. But I think that's a conflict that every investor sort of has to answer. How much diversification can I actually afford? Because it actually, in Goldilocks times, it really hurts. But and coming back to the topic of our panel today, I think with government bonds sort of beginning to fall, or fixed income falling out of the picture more and more, I'm a bit worried that investors, pushed by all the support, will end up with a more focused, more correlated portfolio and become much more vulnerable to what Matthew just said, the reverse gear that may or may not end up occurring, and with everybody invested in the same type of way, pretty much. It's hard to imagine how that is going to actually take place.
Sure, thank you. And Davide, over to you.
We like to put things into perspective. If you look at investment strategy, as Matthew and Michael pointed out before, I mean, few things that 10 years ago were alpha creation strategies now is beta or smart beta. So you got an evolution continuously in terms of market environment on one side, and in terms of looking at this environment and trading this environment. So we are really careful in trying to understand what's changing from a macro and top down point of view, but also from a bottom up perspective. And I think this is crucial for the industry and even more for the hedge fund space. Typically, hedge fund manager, absolute return fund manager, tend to be the front end of something new. So we really like to spend time, energy and analysis in trying to understand what's new and to maintain a forward-looking approach in everything we do in terms of investments.
Sure, okay. Look, we're at 4:03. We've got a whole host of audience questions which are coming in. So I'm going to just read out a few. So one for you, Matthew. So we've got a question which is that I've been a huge fan of the Winton / algo trading approach. What advice would you give to me as a MBA graduate and wanting to get into the market?
Oh, that's a good question. I think you have to actually be interested in the subject matter. If you're interested in having a nice car and flash clothes and a big pay packet, you probably won't succeed. You need to actually be enthusiastic about investing. You need to read. You need to develop your technology skill set. You need to be enthusiastic. And if you do all of those things, I think it'll put you in good stead. But yeah, if you just, you know, if you fancy being like the Wolf of Wall Street and throwing dwarfs into a swimming pool or a dartboard or whatever, then forget it. Like, go into the entertainment industry.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Carolyn, same question to you.
I would wholeheartedly support what Matthew said. I think we've all seen too much of the desire for flashy cars. But I would actually say, in times like this, really be clear on your networking strategy. And I think that could be through coming to panels like this. This could be through your lectures at university. But really be it LinkedIn or anything else, use people that you know and you trust and build that relationship. Not because you need something, but because that's how you will grow.
Great stuff. And then if you can keep them really short and sweet, please, because I've got a whole host that I'd love to get through. Tony, over to you.
I was just going to ask Matthew how you do get the Wolf of Wall Street stuff, you know. But
I'm still searching.
It sounds pretty good to me. But I love the idea of the passion thing, and the curiosity and the passion is what will drive you to success in any field. So I don't think there's a huge size secret to it, you know.
Yeah, thank you, Michael.
Well, I can only add, if you have the curiosity, then naturally you will learn how to code. I guess that is one of the prerequisites for for pretty much, you know, most occupations, and particularly in finance. So yeah,
that's very good. And forgive me, audience, for looking at my phone. I'm actually looking at your questions. So I've got the same question for Davide. I think it's always interesting to hear what you have learned over the years. So Davide.
Well, key thing to me is always be focused on what you want and to understand what are your goals, and without wasting time in other things. I think this is crucial, being enthusiastic, building up your network, and obviously, more importantly, the tools required to achieve or trying to achieve what you really want to do.
Yeah, perfect. I've got about 10 questions to get through, so thank you. Pretty quickly, ESG, and the question is, none of you have mentioned ESG, and so let's quickly go around. What are your thoughts on ESG? How do you weave ESG into your strategies, and what are your thoughts generally on the approach? So let's go first with Michael.
Yeah, we're currently working on getting that done, and it is a tremendous regulatory first of all regulatory task. I believe we're going to find a middle way to acknowledge ESG is important while returns are as well important. I guess that's what everybody's sort of trying to aim at. But our strategy is a very particular one, and some of it lends itself to an ESG approach and some of it doesn't. So we sort of have to make ends meet, and that's quite a load work in front of us. I'm excited to do that, and pretty sure we'll find some common ground to match both worlds.
Okay, that actually dovetails into another question related to this, but let's come on to that in a second. Davide, do you incorporate ESG in your offerings, and if so, how?
In terms of ESG, the main focus for us is to select managers and find an opportunity with a strong ESG component. What we notice quite interesting is that many managers looking at ESG factors in terms of alpha creation. Some time ago, this alpha creation was, in my view, somewhat weak, but the effectiveness of these strategies is increasingly important. That means that all this push in terms of investor about ESG components are defining a new source of alpha, which we believe is quite interesting to observe.
Yeah, great. Thank you. Tony?
Well, I mean, I would just say, you know, beware of sort of pseudo-scientific, you know, pseudo-quantitative approaches is the first thing I'd say. So, you know, be very data-driven in assessing ESG investments, much the same way that you would, you know, assess normal anything else. You know, it's very, very difficult to work out the impact of climate change on a lot of different, you know, economic and financial time series, just because it's a long-term trend as opposed to a cyclical movement. And so therefore, it's just flat out more difficult to model than a cyclical type of pattern. So data, you know, data science and curiosity would be a very, very good mix here. Okay. And I do think it's going to take more years before we truly understand the impact of climate on various investment vehicles.
Okay, that's good. Matthew?
I would very much echo Tony's comments. We really want to try and be objective about ESG, which means ideally trying to capture it with data. There's a long history of well-run companies providing good outcomes for shareholders. So we have a massive focus on governance. Being objective about social and environmental is more difficult. So, you know, certainly we think that businesses that are operating in a sustainable fashion are probably going to end up with better long-term results. But certainly it's the S and it's the E and the S that we are. I think we've got more to go in terms of figuring out how can we incorporate that into our process whilst being really objective and based in data.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Carolyn?
So risk as service, that's one of the things we work with firms and with organisations in really getting that clarity on the vision and on the risk appetite. And I think once you know what you want to be in ESG, then you set up the governance internally to make sure that you have processes in place and you can measure. So let's not forget, it's great to go out to the world and say, this is what we are and this is what we do. If you do not deliver, you lose credibility. And so you need to have the data to back up your claim, and you need to do it consistently. And that's what we help people with.
Yeah, sure. And then look, I mean, I completely agree. I think that ESG is very much driven by individual values. And I think you need to identify what those values are. And off the back of that, incorporate that into your investment policy statement and then try and adhere to it. But we've got about four questions on ESG. So it's so important, and it's really interesting because that's what people want to talk about. So the question that I can see here is from a next gen, and they want to rotate their portfolio to become more ESG compliant. And how can they do that? They're not specifically talking about liquid alts, but clearly that's something I'm assuming that they're interested in. So we partially answered it off the back of Tony talking about time and data and so on. But are there any thoughts, and I'll throw this out to everyone, on that point? Because it is very difficult to measure, and there's a huge issue with ESG data anyway, and the disparity between different data sets. Are there any thoughts on that amongst the panelists? So please feel free to put your hand up. I won't just go around again. Anyone want to take that one? Matthew, please, first.
Yeah, so from my point of view, certainly one of the things I've seen is that right now there's a rather finite supply of your best ESG companies. You know, there aren't that many companies that make solar panels or wind turbines. And so as an investor rotating your portfolio towards some of these themes, you need to be really, really careful that you're not entrusting money to someone who's just going to jump on the bandwagon and be buying, you know, into these sorts of very, very interesting, exciting, interesting opportunities and, you know, well-deserved opportunities, but at a price that just doesn't make sense. So I really feel as though if you're going to rotate your portfolio to be more ESG, I can't see any shortcut other than having to understand a bit more about the product you're looking at, understand exactly how they're going to meet that ESG criteria, and making sure that you're not swapping, you know, an ESG risk for some sort of other risk, or at least if you are swapping it for some other risk, making sure that it's a conscious decision.
Sure. Carolyn, I think your hand was up too.
Yeah, that's pretty much, I was going to say, same as Matthew. Understand your current portfolio and understand where you're trying to get to. You're not going to get from a brown portfolio to a green portfolio within a week. So understand what are the industries that you do not want to have any of, and what are the industries where you're willing to support their journey.
Yeah, perfect. And then we've just got a couple of minutes, but one's coming for Tony. Tony, interest in your question, in the answer to your question about data. What can you offer as GT with respect to data and ESG?
Oh, I mean, well, in terms of ESG, I mean, we're doing a lot of work. I mean, at the moment, I'm currently engaged in an audit with a bank, a UK bank that's been developing stress testing models associated with ESG. We offer, in terms of specifically in terms of data, I mean, we're not really a data provider per se, but, you know, we're certainly aware of all of the large data providers that are out there. I mean, we provide a lot of advisory work related to, you know, to the use of, you know, to ESG investing, to disclosures, to the regulatory requirements around disclosures. You know, we're looking at, you know, there's a range of different stress tests that are currently underway at the moment, mainly in Europe and across the UK, and a lot of the larger financial institutions, the insurance companies, and the banks are, you know, gearing up to be able to run a fully fledged climate stress test. And okay, so we're fully engaged in that process.
Thank you very much. I think the answer is yes, you can, and that's great.
Oh, sorry, yes.
No, that's all right. So we approach Tony directly. There will be a follow-up pack. I'm just going to round off, and I don't want to take up any more of our allotted time. Hugely grateful to the panelists. It's been fantastic hearing your thoughts and your insights. And as you can see, there's a regulatory handbook which GT do provide. Please do request a copy, and I think a copy will be sent, or a link will be sent to you. And just really quickly to wrap up, in terms of your two or three words, what's the next big thing do you feel in finance generally. So Matthew first.
I think life beyond interest rates always going down.
Lovely. That's great. Carolyn, very pithy, please.
I think actually it's a concentration that people will start to concentrate on what products they're excellent at, because that's how you make money.
Thank you, Tony.
Will COVID have a lasting effect?
Okay, that's great. Michael?
Well, really managing the transition into the negative rates world, I think is a huge challenge, and it's okay, underway.
Great, thank you. Davide?
Yeah, negative yields, the new role for alternative investments. This is our big thing.
Fantastic. On that note, thank you so much. Look forward to a follow-up session. Thank you, audience. It's been a pleasure, and I look forward to seeing you all in person. Thank you very much. Have a great afternoon.
Thank you.